John Calvin says this: the resurrection of Christ is the most important article of our faith, and without it, the hope of eternal life is extinguished. In this book, we have seen Jesus through the eyes of women. Women who have been impacted, utilized, and transformed by way of prophecy, discipleship, nourishment, healing, and forgiveness. And now we come to the last chapter where we see women impacted, utilized, and transformed by the power of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. And as I read this chapter through the book, and then the scriptures that were given, I was caught up so much in the names of the women who were there to witness such things and the understanding of the different names used in the different gospels concerning the same events, trying to piece together the timing, the women, the details given, and it kind of overwhelmed me. And I thought I needed to sit with this even more. As much as I've heard and read, there was more I wanted to sit with, and I was so focused on that, I had to step away from the in-depth details to the bigger picture of Christ that came into greater view. And what the Lord spoke to my heart is that there is no resurrection without death, and there is no life without the resurrection. John 10:10 says this: I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. Now, this abundant life is not found in anything that is given or taken away. It is not found in any wealth, treasure, gain, or comfort that this world thinks it has to offer, but rather the life that Christ came to give us abundantly surpasses the present one in every way. This life that is in his glorious presence for all eternity is what awaits us. So again, there is no resurrection without death, and there is no life without the resurrection. We read in her book on page 148 that there is no truth or life in Christianity if Jesus was not raised. There is power and purpose in all of Christ through his life, death, and resurrection, and the women mentioned this week who bear witness to it all bring testimony to this very truth of what he came to do. So in the chapter of our book specifically, we see some women that are mentioned: Joanna, Mary Magdalene, Mary, mother of Jesus, Mary, mother of James and Joseph, Mary, wife of Clopas, Salome. But I'm not going to go into depth into the lives of each of these women and how they viewed Jesus, but I do want us to see that there is significance and importance in the understanding of these women bearing witness and giving testimony to their encounters with Christ and of Christ. The fact that the writers of the Gospels, who under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit chose to include these women, named and unnamed, to be witnesses of the death, burial, and resurrection, and even ascension of Jesus Christ, just reveals so much about the heart of God towards women. Jesus did not see these women through the eyes of man, culture, or society, but through the love and the heart of a holy and heavenly Father. Now, throughout this book that we've read, Jesus Through the Eyes of Women, we are given scriptures that point us to women who would by all means be dismissed, neglected, rejected, or even devalued through the heart and eyes of man, or should I say flesh. But God, he looks at us through the beauty of his beloved Son. The world may dismiss, Christ engages. Where the world neglects, Christ cares for. Where the world rejects, Christ includes. Where the world devalues, Christ gives value to. And in God's kingdom, all who call upon his name shall be saved. All who choose to follow him, he will make fishers of men. All who believe in him will be given the power to go and proclaim the good news. This is more than a male and female thing, even though I know our book is focusing on the women. But it is a saved and an unsaved thing, in Christ or not in Christ. Galatians 3:28 says this: there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. But even so, it is so valuable that we understand the importance of the fact that women viewed, witnessed, and testified to the events that happened not only at the cross, but throughout the Bible. In the first century, women were not even eligible to testify in a Jewish court of law. A witness of women would not have been taken with really much validity. And honestly, some of these women probably wouldn't have even, would have been mocked at or even disregarded. You see, the importance, I read, of witness in the first century is this. According to the Jewish law, proof or confirmation of any truth or of any claim or crime should be supported by more than one witness, by two or three witnesses in particular. And in the Jewish legal system, the role of witnesses was crucially important. A witness appears before a judge to present evidence that will vindicate someone or condemn or refute their opposition. So again, a witness, someone who sees something important or amazing. To bear witness or to testify is a person that shares what they have seen. You see, witnessing is a key theme throughout the Bible, right? Some examples. Israel was to be a witness to all other nations of who, of what, who God is. And they failed, the Israelites, many times were blinded and corrupted, right? Worshiping other gods. And then the Lord is so good. Israel was to be these, but then the Lord sent Moses to be that witness. Then prophets were to be a witness to the people. Even Jesus in Isaiah 61 is called the chief witness. In John 8, we see God is a witness. It says here in John 8:12, Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, I'm the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. The Pharisees replied, you are making those claims about yourself. Such testimony is not valid. It's only one, right? But we go further down to verse 17. It says, your own law, Jesus says that if two people agree about something, their witness is accepted as fact. I am one witness, and my Father who sent me is the other. The word witness is used, I read, over 400 times in the Bible in just a variety of forms. But the witness of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ is crucial to the truth of the gospel. The gospel is not the gospel if death is not conquered. So let's not step there. I want you ladies to come with me. Come with me to the cross for a moment, because this is where the Lord took me. It's more than seeing it through these women, but what these women had seen. And I hope you sat and came there and sat at the cross. And though we see it in Matthew 28, Luke 24, John 20, I'm going to read from Mark's account, and we're just going to look at the crucifixion. We're going to look at the burial. We're going to look at the resurrection and the ascension. This is crucial to the gospel of Christ. This is crucial to what we are being a witness of and what we are supposed to witness to others. And so Mark 15, and I'm reading the NLT, 33 through 40. I'm not going to read. I'm going to read rather quickly, but 33 through 40. At noon, darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. Then at 3 o'clock, and I want you ladies to be there in this moment, Jesus called out with a loud voice, and I'm not going to try to say it, so I'm going to translate it. My God, why have you abandoned me? And some of the bystanders misunderstood and thought he was calling for the prophet Elijah. And one of them ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, holding it up to him on a reed stick so he could drink. Wait, he said. Let's see whether Elijah comes to take him down. Then Jesus uttered another loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the Roman officer who stood facing him saw how he had died, he exclaimed, this man truly was the Son of God. Some of the women were there watching from a distance, including Mary Magdalene, including Mary, the mother of James and the younger and of Joseph and Salome. And I think that's important because the women were there to watch, witness, mourn, and care for Jesus. Think of what that was like to be there, to witness the crucifixion of Christ, the heartache, the pain, I knew I was gonna cry, but the devotion to the Lord that they had. In this book we read on page 151, it said, these women all knew Jesus intimately. They followed him for years. These women didn't just know of Jesus, but they knew him intimately and deeply. And they watched. Ask yourself, do you have an intimate relationship with Christ? Do you follow him closely? You see, their intimacy with Jesus brought familiarity, loyalty, and dependency. These women would be the witness of his death, and therefore they would testify of this crucifixion. For the resurrection to be valid, his death also had to be valid. But it made me think, where are the men? Of the 12 disciples, John, we see, was there comforting Mary. But really only the two criminals, the Roman soldiers, and those that would be part of the Sanhedrin were there. But the women are there to witness something so tragic that I don't even know how their heart would bear it. Not everyone handles death the same or even mourns the same. But through these women, I see great strength, love, and devotion where others would rather not watch. Turn away, it's too much for me. The women were there watching and waiting, mourning and caring through their pain and through their tears. There is power in our waiting. There's power in our mourning. There's power in our pain. There's power in our suffering because there is victory in it all, and God is in it and amongst it all. I want us to go to the burial now, because now they've been a witness of this crucifixion. They've seen, they've watched, they've waited. Their hearts are broken. And now they watch and they see what is happening with the bodies that are there. 42 through verses 47 says this. This all happened on Friday, the day of preparation, the day before the Sabbath. As evening approached, Joseph of Arimathea took a risk and went to Pilate and asked of Jesus' body. Joseph was an honored member of the high council, and he was waiting for the kingdom of God to come. He called for the Roman officer and asked if he had yet died. The officer confirmed that Jesus was dead, so Pilate told Joseph he could have the body. Joseph bought a long sheet of linen cloth, then he took Jesus' body down from the cross, wrapped it in the cloth, and laid it in a tomb that had been carved out of the rock. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where Jesus' body was laid. Again, they watched and they waited. From this passage, there are many things, and man, I wanted to go more into this man. And I did, but I'm not going to go too far. But there's many things that we need to see about Jesus's burial that are so important. I want us to recognize that testify further to the validity of Christ's death and burial, because God leaves no room for doubt or deception. Now, normally the bodies of those who died, because I thought, what about the criminals? What happened to their bodies? And I wanted to, like, what went on with that? What do they do normally? Were to be taken to be in the power of the magistrates, right? Those in the officials and the law, although they were normally granted upon petition to their friends and relatives. But we see here Joseph, who pleaded for his body, and God is sovereign in every detail. He was in a tomb that had not been previously used. Jesus was put in a tomb that had not been previously used so that there would be no suspicion of who rose from it. He was not buried like a criminal, but rather he is buried in a rich man's tomb. And it was a new tomb, so that means it was cut out of a rock. There was no back entrance. There was no way. There was just a cut. It said cut out of a rock, no other entrance. The stone to cover it and two guards. There is no doubt that Jesus had died by the witness account of them, and that he was buried, and that he was put in this place where no man could be or had been or would come from. God left no reason for there to be any other explanation of his resurrection except for the sovereign power and the will of God. But again, we see that not only did the women witness his crucifixion and death, but they watched the embalming of Christ. Now think how hard this is. I'm thinking that I just lost an aunt recently on Monday. And so this really sat with me. But the burial, it just brings this certainty of death, doesn't it? We know a person has died, but when you see them for the last time, when you know that they've been buried, it just brings this certainty. And their witness would testify. All of these that have been mentioned, the women, Joseph, it would testify to the legitimacy of his death and his burial. But this brings us to the resurrection. Mark 16, 1 through 11. And Saturday evening, when the Sabbath ended, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome went out and purchased burial spices so they could anoint Jesus' body. Very early on Sunday morning, just as sunrise, they went to the tomb, and on the way they were asking each other, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" But as they arrived, they look up and they saw the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled aside. A And when they had entered the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and the women were shocked. But the angel said, "Don't be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Look, this is where they laid his body. Now go and tell his disciples, including Peter, that Jesus is going ahead of you to Galilee, and you will see him there just as he told you before he died." And the women fled from the tomb, trembling and bewildered, and they said nothing to anyone except because they were too frightened. And then we see, as you read on, there's these things where it says the shorter ending, the longer ending. Let's go on to chapter verse 9. And it says, "After Jesus rose from the dead early on Sunday morning, the first person who saw him was Mary Magdalene, the woman whom he had cast seven demons out of. She went to the disciples who were grieving and weeping and told them Jesus was alive and that she had seen them, but they didn't believe her." I just want to take that whole resurrection, and I love what the author had said of this book on page 165. "In a culture where women were often silenced, Jesus commissions a female disciple to announce his resurrection to his male disciples." Now imagine these women going there, ready to touch his body for the last time, maybe, to see his face, whatever it may be. Imagine the fear, the confusion, the shock, the wonderment of how the unexplained could possibly be explained. This is the gospel. And the gospel is testified through the witness of these women. We just read it because of the witness and testimony of these women and the obedience to the writers of this gospel under the Spirit of God. Jesus, through the eyes of these women, is what? Is that he is the risen Lord. Through their firsthand experiences, testimony, and witness, they have revealed the gospel to the world around them, that our triune God gives life and life more abundantly, that he is worthy to be known, praised, worshiped, and loved. What these women have started, we get to continue. We get to be the witness now that testify to his truth, his provision and satisfaction. We get to bear witness of his indwelling and leading, his healing and his restoring, his forgiveness and grace, and most importantly, his gift of everlasting life that we now have through the resurrected Christ. Praise God, we get to do that. If others were to read about our life, or better yet, see our life, could they see Jesus through it? The way we took the time to see Jesus through the eyes of these women, could we take the time to look at your life and see Jesus through the eyes of you? Do you even see Jesus through the eyes that you have been given? The Lord wants to utilize, impact, and transform us today, where he has us today, to proclaim the truth of the gospel today, to be witnesses, to testify of him in our homes, in our church, in our community, in our city, and abroad today. Because it's less about the one who is testifying and more about the one we are getting to testify about. Acts 22 says this. I wanted to take us here because this is beautiful to me. And this is when Paul, you know, he was blinded. The Lord spoke to him and he had seen him through the light. And then all of a sudden he could see. And Ananias told Paul this. "The God of our ancestors has chosen you to know his will and to see the righteous one and hear him speak. For you are to be his witness, telling everyone what you have seen and heard." What are you waiting for? Like, that just spoke to me. What are we waiting for? We were blind and we've been given sight. We were lost and we are found. We were dead and now we're made alive. What are we waiting for? What more could we possibly be waiting for to proclaim? So he says, "Get up and be baptized. Have your sins washed away by calling on the name of the Lord." That is where it starts with. Calling on the name of the Lord. Be baptized. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now go out and tell everyone all that he has done and all who he is. The fact that we get to be witnesses, ambassadors of Jesus Christ, testifying of who he is, what he's done, what he has promised to do, is something that really we should marvel at. Do we? Do we marvel at that? That he's given us this mouth, this body, this heart, this mind to understand him, to know him, deeply and intimately for the sake of what? For ourselves? Just to grow in that knowledge? No, to go out and testify. This whole Bible is the testimony of those whom the Lord has used, transformed, corrected, changed, and it all points to Jesus Christ's death, resurrection, and ascension. So I want to read this account real quick from John. We're almost done here. John 18, 35 through 37. And it says, Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests had delivered you to me? What have you even done?" Right? This is what they're bringing Jesus. And he's like, "What have you done?" And Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate therefore said, "Are you a king then?" And Jesus answered, "You say rightly that I'm a king." And this is beautiful to me. "For this cause I was born," Jesus says. "And for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth." If Jesus has come to bear witness to the truth, and we are now in Christ, aren't we to bear witness to the truth? Is this not what we have been born and what we have come to do? "Everyone," he says, "who is of the truth hears my voice." I want to leave us lastly in the ascension, because we've seen that the women were there. We feel the pain of the crucifixion, which really takes away the sins. We see the death and the burial, and now we see the resurrection, which now we see him as Lord, Savior, Sovereign, and what now? He ascends. Acts 1, verse 6 says this. So when the apostles were with Jesus, they kept asking him, "Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom?" Oh, their sight was still on what's around. "Lord, have you come yet to heal me? Have I spent time with you enough and intimately enough for you to use me, for you to show me, for you to answer these prayers that I've been waiting for? For you to make this world a better and happy place to live in?" And Jesus replied this, "The Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times, and they are not for you to know. But verse 8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Ladies, he has ascended and left you the power of the Holy Spirit, so that you have the Spirit that will come upon you, and that you will be witnesses." After saying this, he was taken up in a cloud while they were watching, and they could no longer see him. I love that, because could you imagine? Just like that little balloon where you're just like, "I just want to see it until I absolutely can't see it." And as they strained to see him rising into heaven, two white-robed men suddenly stood among them. "Men of Galilee," they said, and I'm going to end with this, "why are you standing here, staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but someday he will return from heaven in the same way you saw him go." Ladies, it's great that we are set our face like flint towards Jesus. But we have been given a purpose. We have been given a calling. We have been given empowerment to do what? To go while we're here and make disciples, to testify of this gospel truth. We are to be intimately close in proximity and love and heart to the Father for the sake of what? That the gospel may be known. Because you know what? One day he will return from heaven in the same way that these men or disciples saw him go. There's power in the waiting. There's power in the pain. There's power in their suffering. And there's power in the life that we have been given abundantly.